will it take for us to get that videotape? The end of the world.
Allá, viene una tormenta.
What did he just say?
He said there's a storm coming in.
Developing overseas, the death toll after the devastating earthquake in Turkey and Syria is rising. This morning, officials are reporting more than 33,000 people are dead.
Rain on Molokai over the weekend, creating raging rivers in residents' yards. For these Kapa'akea residents, it was a race against heavy rain and flooding to save their belongings. The National Weather Service says these types of systems aren't uncommon, but it is rare to see leeward portions of the state get this amount of rain.
The chemtrail generator.
Oh.
I want to make sure that that thing's working. We're going to check this out.
I got it. 3.6.
Oh, look at that. They're working. They're working. You can see the chemtrails coming out of the entrance here. Look at that.
I'm dying to take a picture of
that's cool.
My neighbor, you got it. So I
chemtrail see. I'm doing a video. Chemtrail generators are on. And yeah, there it is. Look, you can see them. All right. That's awesome.
It's
working.
This is the world you are graduating into. This is what I want to talk about today with you for a few minutes. To lead in shaping a new world order for the 21st century.
All right, so let's talk about it with Dr. Emmanuel DiLorenzo, professor and director of a new program in ocean science and engineering at Georgia Tech. Thanks for being with us this morning. Let's start off with what was in the article. According to it, scientists are investigating whether releasing a chemical compound into the air will slow Earth's warming. Is that even possible?
Theoretically, it's very possible. In fact, I think it's very sound science. And from a science perspective, I think it's a very interesting kind of geoengineering approach. Mm-hmm. But if we consider the human factor, this type of approach feels to me like taking a climate pill. And let me explain what I mean by that. Imagine you're a patient and you go to your doctor for high cholesterol.
Yeah.
And the doctor gives you two options. The first option is change your lifestyle, maybe reduce your calorie, exercise, and try to reduce your cholesterol and be healthier. The other approach is take the antistatin, the anti-cholesterol drug. And, you know, most people would say, yes, you know, changing your lifestyle is a good thing to do. But then at the end of the day, most people will actually take the pill.
Right.
And so I suspect that in this case of the climate analogy, most governments will end up rather taking the climate pill than doing the hard work of lowering their.
All right, so then the question becomes, does taking the pill produce worse side effects than we originally started with?
Well, here's the thing. Taking this pill could be dangerous.
When I was a kid, I used to see these trails in the sky all the time. And so, oh, that's cool. A jet just went over. And then you started to see a whole bunch of them. And the next thing you know, everybody in your neighborhood was fighting and arguing, and you didn't know why. Okay? And you really didn't know why. I mean, everybody was fighting.
As Ogden Marsh Township. Population 1,200. Then we have this shot. Two chemtrail jets flying across the sky, laying heavy chemtrails. This is the only chemtrail shot in the entire film. And then the title of the film, The Crazies. 19 minutes into the film, we get our first shot of the cause of the zombification. The chemtrail jet crashed in a marsh.
You said it sounded like a plane, Trev? Sheriff, about the reward. Should big plane, little plane, what? Come on now.
Well, if you can explain the difference how those two sound, I might be able to figure it out.
People only ask for reward when there's something to find.
Is it going to be a big reward, Sheriff?
Travis, you ask about that again, I'm going to throw you out of the boat.
And you're not going to shoot me?
Travis?
Yeah?
Kill the engine. It's a big plane, Russ.
Why is that?
Because we're right on top of it.
Here we see the crashed chemtrail jet with engines sticking out of the water. And at the end of this scene, again we have the eye in the sky.
Okay, so has there been any testing on this theory, or is there any way even to test it?
I think that in the New York Times articles, the scientists at Harvard were trying to put in place an experiment somewhere, I don't remember in which region, to actually try to release some of these chemical compounds and measure all these radiative balances that take place. But
I was going to say, how do you test this? Because you have such a large patient, if you will.
I don't know if a regional test of this kind of release of compounds would scale to a global effect. Mm-hmm. And then there's all the issues of time scales, like, you know, some of the responses of climate Earth are delayed.
Right, that's
so
true.
So imagine, like, you have a knob in your shower, in an old shower, and you're turning the knob towards the hot water, and it's not coming.
It's freezing, so we all know that, doctor.
And then all of a sudden it becomes so hot, and you're like, oh my gosh, it's so hot, and you turn it down so quick, and then it gets hard to actually balance that. These two
all right, Dr. Lorenzo, we certainly appreciate you coming on. And the question is, can we outsmart Mother Nature?
It's a big globe out
there. She always seems to, you know, react.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
This is Craig's job, firing chemicals into the clouds in a controversial attempt to modify the weather.
According to the World Meteorological Organization, 52 countries have a weather modification program. Insurance companies like ones in Alberta fund cloud seeding projects in order to lessen damage claims they receive.
But you could do it for reducing hail. They've tried it on hurricanes to modify hurricanes, to reduce the intensity of hurricanes.
To do that, pilots target clouds full of moisture and eject small amounts of an inert chemical.
Weather modification programs, experimental ones done by private companies, done by the United States government, done by states across the United States, are underway. There's more than 50 of them in operation across the United States. There are programs around the world. International corporations are modifying our weather all the time, and they're modifying it in ways that cover thousands and thousands of square miles. Most of it is chemically altered. So that what happens is that we are putting chemicals, ground-based chemicals that are shot into the air, or chemicals coming from airplanes that change and modify our weather.
I've been told I have some control issues. I've learned that it's really, really hard to control people. So I'm going to try to control something that's a lot easier than people. I'm going to try to control the weather. Yeah, right. It'd be a little difficult to make it rain, right? That would be something that only God can do, right? Because I'm going to do something that God can't do. I'm not just going to make it clear up. No. I'm going to make it actually stop. Now, can God do that? No, I don't think so. Or what about make it go up.
We are no longer dancing in tune, as it were, with nature's rhythms.
And as a direct result, our environment is losing its capacity to sustain it.
King Charles III wants to protect the planet for future generations, a passion he has highlighted for decades. His efforts have included championing initiatives to engage businesses around conversations about sustainability.
All organisms depend on a state of harmony to be healthy. Yet our species has made such powerful and unhealthy changes to this planet that we are increasingly out of harmony with our environment.
I don't know, just go insane.
King Charles has also taken initiatives in his own homes, like solar panel systems and ensuring safe habitats for animals. In July, the King-in-Waiting called for an Astro Carta to establish sustainable space exploration.
After I saw the trailer, all I could think of was major propaganda for climate change. It is exactly what the Luciferian Illuminati establishment wants us to believe. They are using the big screen TV, video games, cartoons, TV shows, what have you, to push this same agenda of climate change and that there's going to be some kind of disaster that is coming. And I honestly believe without a doubt that they are going to be the ones that engineer it. So if we look at some screenshots of what even IMDb is talking about, I will show you some information as to what I believe is being shown here. And anyways, IMDb says, when the network of satellites designed to control the global climate, and in my opinion, the worldwide climate, there's no such thing as a globe, start to attack Earth, it's a race against the clock to uncover the real threat before a worldwide geostorm wipes out everything and everyone. So take note that it says, you know, basically these satellites get taken over. So literally showing now there's climate terrorists or people that are taking over these satellites or supposed satellites, because we will see that really many people know that satellites are also fake. They're not real. And basically saying that this is a geostorm, which is totally a man-made engineered kind of thing that is being shown here. And, you know, really, when we look at some screenshots here, we will see that the Illuminati signature is everywhere as the trailer begins with scenes of lightning in the sky, to me denoting symbolism for Lucifer's fall from heaven. You know, are we also being shown whose people are behind this fear propaganda, aka Lucifer and his minions are behind this propaganda for major climate change agenda propaganda? In the trailer, we see not only is it propaganda for climate change, but more space deception as well. You know, the establishment really wants humanity to believe in climate change, to believe in space race, to believe in evolution, to believe in all this nonsense that is just all lies, but it's really all CGI fakery. And sadly, the world has just bought up and eaten up this fakery that we're being shown constantly. So here we see a scene of a rocket ship going up into space, which is again just all nonsense. And you know, as we keep going, we see, you know, this rocket ship apparently going to this supposed, you know, International Space Station. But really, NASA and the establishment really want you to believe in space age. And you know, the funny thing is, how does the ISS even keep up with the Earth if, according to their numbers, we're spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, and we're also supposedly hurtling through space at 66,000 miles per hour? So how do all the supposed satellites even keep up with us? How can they even do anything up there if we're hurtling through space so fast? But you know, we don't even see any satellites in any of the supposed pictures of Earth from space. When we take a look at some of this stuff, you know, we'll see that, you know, the Earth really should look like this. If we're truly on a globe and there's thousands of satellites up there, we should be seeing pictures like this. Or, you know, that, of course, this is good old CGI again.
In 2002, Blue Marble 2.0, NASA's Rob Simmon made this. And it had wide appeal too. For example, it ended up as the default background on the iPhone.
I didn't even know until I bought an iPhone and turned it on and kind of did a little happy dance.
Simmons' job is...
it's primarily taking data and making pictures out of it.
That's what this is. A composite of data sets from several different instruments translated into a picture.
To us, the really cool thing was the data set. Up until that point, there was no realistic color map of the globe anywhere.
So the land layer here comes from...
the moderate resolution imaging spectral radiometer aboard Terra.
And the tricky part here was the weather.
So we actually had to take clouds out.
They stashed the clouds for later, went onto the ocean. That came from an instrument that measures phytoplankton in the sea.
Where it was low, I colored it dark blue because they're low mostly in mid-oceans. And then where it was a little bit higher, it was like a little bit brighter green.
Then add the clouds back in.
There's a small problem with it because there's a very slight gap in between each orbit.
So some of those are painted on.
It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be.
Then
there was another layer to sort of simulate the atmosphere.
And then there's this little bright spot.
It's called the specular highlight. So it's the reflection of sunlight off of water.
Those are the pieces, but you can't just slap them all together.
It just didn't look realistic. It looks kind of flat, or the clouds are sort of too see-through. So I just hit Command Z a lot.
There's artistry to creating the world.
What I imagine it to be. Unfortunately, I'm not an astronaut. I've never been to space, but I've looked at these images over and over again, trying to sort of get the essence of it. It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be.
There should be satellites all over the place.
Now, I don't want to fool you here. Last month, for the first time since 1972, NASA released a blue marble, a single snapshot of the Earth taken from outer space. And so much has changed in the decades between that first picture and the second. Borders have shifted, generations have come and gone, our global population has nearly doubled. But one thing hasn't changed. Our planet is as beautiful as ever. It still looks blue.
Charles's commitment to mitigating climate change has even been evident in recent years and months.
Development of technology like electric vehicles or green hydrogen, for that matter, for heavy transport, is vital for maintaining the health of our world for future generations.
Charles inherited his passion for conservation from his parents and has passed it on to the next generation.
Since his rise to head of the Catholic Church, Pope Francis's papacy has been nothing short of transformative. Redefining the role from day one, wearing white at his inaugural mass, not gold like his predecessor, and readily greeting crowds in an open-top Jeep, even stopping to bless a man. Since then, Francis has spoken out on topics usually avoided by sitting pontiffs, like divorce, gender equality, even gay rights. But no issue has captured his attention more than the dire fate of our warming planet.
Now is the time for courageous
action and strategies.
In 2015, he published a sweeping encyclical, an open letter to the church, the first by a pope to focus on climate change. Writing, it represents one of the principal challenges facing humanity in our day. British ambassador to the Vatican Chris Trott says Francis's passion for the environment is rooted in his faith.
The role that Pope Francis is playing on this issue has been historic. How so?
He sees that he has a kind of a moral voice that he can use and should use to influence global politics. So he thinks that climate is a critical issue for the whole of humankind right now.
So I've been working in this space now pretty much for 30 years. And I think in the past, I would have said that we had a bit more time to really think through leadership and to have all the right conversations that we needed to have. I'm feeling now, as the new president of the Club of Rome, and taking into consideration that the Limits to Growth, our first publication alerting the world to the fact that we needed to really focus on consumption and the impact on our planetary boundaries. That was published 50 years ago. And so I'm feeling a sense of urgency. We've obviously seen the IPCC report, now also the LAMS report, looking both at biodiversity and climate convergence. So for me, leadership now is about ambition. And it's about being able to be brave enough to turn around these emergencies into unbelievable opportunities to emerge from emergency. And how do we do that? Taking the leadership of some of the best companies out there that are really looking at decarbonization. I think there's been an unbelievable transition in Europe, both in terms of policy and also in terms of business moves towards the right conversations in their value chain and also stepping up to the plate. And I commend your electric for being a real leader in moving in this direction with the power sector.
If you can't hear what I'm saying, I couldn't even hear myself. This is the loudest sound you could possibly conceive. And as it turns out, the cleanest.
Now, the most amazing thing is that that cloud up there, which was generated by the engine, is just a mixture of hydrogen and oxygen. It's water vapor. And in about an hour's time, someone in Mississippi is going to get wet washing. It will actually rain.
I told you. It's raining. That's unbelievable. Oh.
NASA's playing God. It's making its own weather.
Project Cirrus, a massive operation jointly conducted in 1947 with the General Electric Laboratory, the Office of Naval Research, the U.S. Weather Bureau, the U.S. Army Signal Corps, and the Air Force. And as newspaper articles described, during Project Cirrus, they sprayed silver iodide into a hurricane in 1947. And they did so when the hurricane was a couple days out from the East Coast trajectory, and it worked. After successfully seeding the hurricane, it changed directions and accelerated, crashing into the coast of Savannah, Georgia, wreaking major havoc on its inhabitants, destroying property, and creating an inquiry in Congress, who seemed largely critical and quite perturbed at the supposition that steering this hurricane had artificially fueled it and created a loose cannon with disturbing potential consequences. The public at large was furious, lawsuits were formed, and the DOD was suddenly on the defensive. Official denials came down, attempting to quell public anger and diffuse blame. A 13-year moratorium was placed on weather experimentation, and the key players went back to the drawing board. But Irving Langmuir openly took credit for manipulating the weather and boasted about its success, tone-deaf to the sentiments of the public, and apparently callous to the collateral damage that this new technology was capable of wielding. During that same year, Project Cirrus also tested, quote, cloud controls to modify winter weather in the northern U.S., and Dr. Langmuir announced that he was working to prevent hailstorms during thunderstorms, the stopping of all ice storms, the freezing of rain, and cloud icing that endangers flying. Furthermore, in an April 1947 experiment that echoed the fictionalized Ice Nine of Kurt Vonnegut's novel, Langmuir described to the press his attempts at cloud cutting in the northern New York and Massachusetts Berkshire Mountain country. It was done in a cloud filled with unfrozen moisture that had been chilled to below freezing by artificially induced chemical reactions, namely by dropping some 25 pounds of dry ice from a plane into the cloud, which in turn could transform into snow or rain. The plane flew an L-shaped course, and the color of the L changed within a few minutes. Its moisture turned into snow, some of which at first boiled upwards. This kind of snow would not ice an airplane. Soon the snow fell and the L changed into a canyon in the cloud. In 30 minutes, this canyon was 1,000 feet deep. This canyon widened and lengthened rapidly. It cut completely down through the cloud and was about 3 miles wide and lengthened to 15 miles.
You know, they were talking about climate change yesterday, and now we're learning that scientists and researchers are looking at how to change the weather on purpose. That's right. Lasers now could one day manipulate rain and lightning. CBS This Morning contributor Michio Kaku is a physics professor at City College of New York. Professor, nice to see you. Extraordinary seeing Al Gore and Bill Clinton there together with Charlie, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, they did not get into this discussion,
no.
though. But it is fascinating. I mean, lasers, really, to change the weather?
That's right. Well, as Mark Twain once famously said, everyone complains about the weather, but no one ever does anything about it. Well, instead of doing a rain dance, we physicists are firing trillion-watt lasers into the sky to actually precipitate rain clouds and actually bring down lightning bolts. This is potentially a game changer.
But this is experimental.
It's experimental. However, in the laboratory so far, it works. When you have water vapor and you have dust particles or ice crystals, you can precipitate rain. It condenses around the seeds. These seeds can also be created by laser beams. By firing trillion-watt lasers, you rip apart the electrons, creating what are called ions, and these ions act like seeds, like dust particles, bringing down rain and even lightning.
Go ahead.
Well, this fascinates me in part because, too, I remember reading the stories that China had used this during the Olympics, that the USSR had used this after Chernobyl to create rain clouds. I mean, did those really work then? We have some of these capabilities now?
Inconclusive. Even in the 60s, the CIA used this to bring down monsoons during the Vietnam War to wash out the Viet Cong. Governments have been playing with this thing.
Alleged to,
right.
Yeah.
Now, we realize that for decades now, these governments have been alleged to have experimented with weather control, but nothing conclusive. This time we're bringing in the laws of physics rather than simply waving our hands and uttering mumbo jumbo. We're actually using trillion-watt lasers now. And in the laboratory, sure enough, they precipitate rain out of water vapor. Sure enough, you can actually bring down electricity down the beam.
So what does it mean for drought areas that need to have rain for crops? And if they don't have them, there's the consequences of famine.
Well, the bad news is, if it's a clear blue sky, it's not going to do anything at all, because it only takes water vapor that's already in the air and condenses it. However, for floods, for agriculture, farmers, for people planning wedding parties, football games, you name it, outdoor events and agriculture and flooding and even hurricanes, all of them could be subject to weather modification.
Incredibly interesting. Professor Michio Kaku, thank you so much.
Tonight we begin a News 12 special series, Remembering 9/11. With the 10th anniversary approaching, we're going to take a look back at the terror attacks that changed America forever. Now, you may not be aware, a hurricane was forecast for New York that fateful day, a storm that could have conceivably changed history. News 12 meteorologist Joe Rayo is here with Remembering 9/11. Joe.
Well, absolutely, Brian. You know, the weather has played a role, a crucial role, in many historical events, from D-Day to the explosion of the Space Shuttle Challenger. And tonight, in the wake of Hurricane Irene, ironically enough, how another storm may have made a difference, for on the day before 9/11, all eyes were focused on a major hurricane. From here on Chopper 12, we have access to spectacular panoramic views of the greater New York metropolitan area. And these scenes are enhanced on this particular morning by the weather. Indeed, it's the kind of day that meteorologists might categorize as severe clear. And now, still under construction, yet looming large in our view, is One World Trade Center. You know, seeing this particular edifice against these blue skies is a haunting reminder of the weather conditions on that tragic day 10 years ago, a gorgeous morning in late summer. But had the weather been just a little different, the tragic events that we now associate with the date September 11, 2001, might never have happened. The day before 9/11, over the greater New York area, skies were turbulent with extensive cloud cover, accompanied by scattered showers. I remember that day very well. I was here at News 12 doing my evening weathercast and showing our viewers satellite images of a very powerful storm, a Category 3 hurricane, Hurricane Erin, which was moving on a track that would take it, perhaps the next day, right into the tri-state metropolitan area. Notice also the movement. It's moving toward the northwest, and if it were to keep on moving, it would be heading right toward Long Island and southern New England, but it's not going to do that. But then I pointed out that the cold front that was moving through our area would ultimately push Erin away from the east coast. Will be turned around and moved to the north and northeast, out of the picture for us as this cold front comes on in and through, and for all intents and purposes just boom, kicks Erin right on out to sea.
I was actually happy to tell our viewers that we were going to dodge a major weather bullet, that the hurricane was going to veer away from the eastern seaboard, that September 11th was going to be a beautiful day, blue skies and bright sunshine. In retrospect, maybe it would have been better if we had to deal with the hurricane.
The front moves through, less humid air moves in, and sunshine.
You know, if that cold front had been just 24 to 36 hours slower than it was, the weather on 9/11 might have been much different than it turned out to be.
Well, world, this is it. You know, I always thought you'd die before me. Now as I prepare my soul for an eternity of fire and poking.
Yeah, less chat, more splat, pal.
Hey, Mr. S, I didn't know you bungeed.
I want to live.
No, no, you're too heavy.
It's a glandular problem. Orlacht! Chuds! Mole people!
There is no escape from the fortress of the moles. No, except that.
Ow!
I actually lived in room 3327 and 3320.
Eine Nikola Tesla room. The great inventor Nikola Tesla occupied this room from 1933 to 1943. He invented the system of AC electrical power that is used throughout the world today, including the generator, motor, and methods of transmission. He also holds the patent for wireless communication. Okay. Perhaps his most famous project is the electrical power plant at Niagara Falls.
Nikola Tesla was a brilliant inventor who spent most of his career in the USA. He was an electrical engineer and produced works which explored the idea of radio and wireless transmissions. He began researching high-frequency AC. First in his lab on Houston Street in New York City and then at a lab close to Colorado Springs. Tesla's early experiments uncovered the fundamental methods to enable practical radio communication. He demonstrated this by generating 16-foot discharges in his New York City laboratory in 1894. Tesla became convinced that wireless transmission of electric power was possible. Tesla invented polyphase electric power. All present-day polyphase systems stem from Tesla's genius. Tesla was able to visualize objects, including inventions he was building down to the smallest detail. His method of working was pretty unorthodox compared to other inventors, as he rarely created sketches or drawings, relying solely on the power of his own imagination to work out details. Something strange that happened to him in his early childhood is flashes of light. These flashes of light were frequently followed by inspiration or solution to problems. Nikola Tesla stated that he had created an earthquake, which drew police and ambulances to the region of his laboratory. This occurred in 1898 and was the result of a machine he was working on. This machine worked with vibrations. He said the following: "I was experimenting with vibrations. I had one of the machines going and I wanted to see if I could get it in tune with the vibration of the building. I put it up notch after notch. There was a peculiar cracking sound. I asked my assistants where did the sound come from. They did not know. I put the machine up a few more notches. There was a louder cracking sound. I knew I was approaching the vibration of the steel building. I pushed the machine a little higher. Suddenly, all the heavy machinery in the place was flying around. I grabbed a hammer and broke the machine. The building would have been about our ears in a few minutes. Outside in the streets, police and ambulances arrived. I told my assistants to say nothing. We told the police it must have been an earthquake. That's all they ever knew about it." Tesla went on to say that vibrations will do anything. It would only be necessary to step up the vibrations of the machine to fit the natural vibration of the building, and the building would come crashing down. That's why soldiers break step crossing a bridge.
This is the additional video to show Tesla mechanical oscillator that we've shown in detail during the Westcom exhibit. Is now deflevering the whole table. And you can see the effect on the doors. This table has two frequencies. It has the one that deflevering the whole table and separate one that affects mostly the doors.
This NASA and the establishment really want you to believe this is real. You know, you got to hand it to them, really. They do a really good job with the, you know, their CGI. Even in this movie, this looks, you know, very real. But, you know, when I saw this, immediately I saw the six-pointed cube star. Can you see it? There's six sides to this this shape here. You can see these six lines making the Rothschild star of Remphan, the star what people think is the star of David. It's just not. It really is a complete Jesuit Illuminati Caesarian Rothschild deception that is going on here. So right away you can see the cube of Saturn. This is what is really being shown here. They're showing their signature, okay, the cube or the cult of Saturn, the IXXI. It is all cube, Saturn, Sun worship. Satan worship is what is being shown here. So don't be fooled. They put their signatures in plain sight. So really, yet again, we are seeing who is in control of Hollywood, of the media. It is the Illuminati cabal. That is what's going on here. And later on, we see, to me, what looks like the bottom of the satellite literally looks like the womb of ISIS is opening up and the Illuminati is about to release their plan. So is the Luciferian establishment wants to blame humanity for climate change.
Concern about air quality usually centers on pollution, as in the ironic observation, if you can't see it, don't breathe it. Increased reliance on coal is a crucial part of the Carter administration energy program, but the Senate Energy and Natural Resources Committee heard warnings today that a coal-burning society may be making things hot for itself. Nelson Benton reports.
The so-called greenhouse effect is created by carbon dioxide, a colorless, odorless gas. In small concentrations, it helps to sustain almost all life on Earth. The relatively small amounts of carbon dioxide in the Earth's atmosphere filter the warming rays of the sun to the Earth's surface. But like a greenhouse, carbon dioxide also prevents heat given off by the Earth from escaping into space. Researchers say increasingly large amounts of CO2 are accumulating in the atmosphere. They fear the Earth will gradually become warmer, causing as yet uncertain but possibly disruptive changes in the Earth's climate 50 to 70 years from now. Fossil fuels, when burned, release carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Coal, the worst culprit, oil and natural gas to lesser degrees. Scientists and a few politicians are beginning to worry that global energy planning does not take the greenhouse effect seriously enough. If the Earth gets too warm, for example, ice caps could melt, raising the level of the seas.
Possible probable, we really don't know. But if it happens, it means goodbye Miami, goodbye Corpus Christi, goodbye Sacramento, goodbye Boston, which obviously is much more of a concern, goodbye New Orleans, goodbye Charleston, Savannah, and Norfolk. On the positive side, it means that we could enjoy boating at the foot of the Capitol and fishing on the South Lawn.
One model of climate, the Jason climate model, predicts that doubling carbon dioxide will result in August in Washington, D.C., that are 9 degrees centigrade warmer, or 16 degrees Fahrenheit, than current summers, but that the winters will only be 2 degrees centigrade warmer. Changes of this magnitude are very probably going to have a profound effect on agriculture, on all aspects of energy use and generation, and on water and land use.
One scientist put the urgency of the greenhouse potential in biblical terms, citing the warning given to Noah in the Old Testament. Noah knew trouble was coming, he said, and he prepared for it. Nelson Benton, CBS News, Capitol Hill.
Funny that they're the ones that are engineering this climate change through this, you know, geostorm or this geoengineering of theirs, but they want to blame humanity. Go figure. But in reality, this movie is revealing just who is behind climate change. Don't fall for the lies that humanity is destroying the world. It's just not real, okay? It truly is the establishment who's destroying this world, because we have seen, I've shown this article in the video I did recently on that movie, The Thinning. This article talks about human population growth and climate change. They really want to say that it's human population that is destroying the atmosphere, that we're breathing out too much carbon dioxide and creating too much of greenhouse gases, when the funny thing is the Earth actually needs greenhouse gases. So it's all Luciferian lunacy, if you ask me. And then, of course, you know, I showed before an article about HAARP, you know, talking about that it's basically a secret weapon for weather modification. And you can, again, take a look at this article for yourself. But really, they actually acknowledge that the experiments are conducted using electromagnetic frequencies to fire pulse-directed energy beams in order to temporarily excite a limited area of the ionosphere. So they are totally messing with the weather.
This facility was built by the Air Force about 20 years ago to study the ionosphere, to do active experiments in the ionosphere. The ionosphere is a layer that surrounds the Earth at about 100 kilometers up to maybe 2,000 kilometers. It's important for a lot of things, like satellite communication. Any kind of radio signals that pass through the ionosphere are affected by the ionosphere. Each of these trailers you see around me have transmitters in them. The transmitters feed power from the main building over there up into these dipole antennas. And basically there are 180 antennas radiating high frequency waves up in the ionosphere. It's a big ham radio, a big HF radio, the biggest in the world. Fundamentally what this is about is taking the ionosphere at 100 kilometers up and turning it into a laboratory. We can do experiments. We can create bubbles. We can heat small sections. We can create waves. We can excite plasma resonances and do a lot of experiments. We can transmit signals all around the world. We can study the effects of the ionosphere. It basically makes the ionosphere a laboratory. And we can do experiments that no one else can do. It's a laboratory without walls.
I'm not buying what Michael Murphy's selling. I'm even more skeptical now. I don't think he knows enough about the weather to be talking about this. I enjoy talking to Kristen, but she's making some crazy claim. Uh-oh, here we go. HAARP. Every conspiracy theorist's ears just got a little bit bigger. For those of you who don't know what HAARP is, it's a top secret military installation. The strange weather patterns, the zombie storms. Even though it's clear that something's going on, I'm not buying that chemtrails are causing all these things. Here's what I learned on my journey. What people are calling chemtrails are not the government spraying evil chemicals on you. They look like clouds because they are clouds.
They're gonna turn us into a third world country.
People are familiar with that thin blue line that the astronauts bring back in their pictures from space. That's the part of the atmosphere that has oxygen. It's only 5 to 7 kilometers thick. We're still putting 162 million tons into it every single day. That's what's boiling the oceans, creating the droughts and melting the ice and raising the sea level and causing these waves of climate refugees. Every piece of pro-climate legislation, the oil and gas industry and the coal industry, they come in and fight it tooth and nail. and they use their legacy network of political influence and wealth to stop progress. The rest of us have to reform these international institutions so that the people of this world can say, we are now in charge of our own destiny. We're going to save the future and give people hope. We can do it. And remember that political will is itself a renewable resource.
This is Al Jazeera.
Al Jazeera has purchased Current TV, Al Gore's left-leaning channel, in an attempt to broaden its reach into U.S. homes. The move, however, had the reverse effect. Time Warner dropped Current TV shortly after the deal was confirmed. Analysts say the move wasn't so much over Al Jazeera's programming, but rather a lack of enthusiasm for the former vice president's endeavor. Acquiring Current TV allows for a wider distribution network.
So Al Jazeera coming in and purchasing Current TV is really sort of a way that current owners of Current TV can have an exit strategy, recoup some of its financial losses, and what Al Jazeera English now gets is sort of that broadcast distribution among cable and satellite homes that's been lacking for many, many years.
I wanted to get today more into the directed energy weapons used, being used all around the world today. It's being used, has been used in China, up in the Beast Fires, Fort Murray in Alberta, Canada, Gatlinburg, Tennessee, Madeira, Portugal, Santa Rosa, Sonoma County, Butte County, Mendocino County, Lake County here in Northern California, and now we have Southern California under attack. These are attacks, folks. They're undercounting the directed energy weapons being used. No one's talking about them except here on the internet, but you can clearly see. They melt engine blocks, folks.
Lasers. Sound like the stuff of science fiction, right? Sound completely unbelievable. How could our military possibly be using those in future warfare? Guess what? We've just had a recent breakthrough, more great test results that are making lasers a reality. So it's called Athena. Lockheed Martin makes it, and they've been doing a lot of the pioneering in this laser field. Now, what's really exciting about it is that it's so hard to harness that much power and make it compact enough that it's actually going to make practical sense downrange. And they've proven that they can do that. Recently, they tested it against 5 moving drones, so realistic drones that they might go up against with, enemy forces might send against us, for example, or terrorists might send against us. And it successfully shot down all 5 of the drones. This is huge news because it means that in a realistic, practical setting, it's looking very promising, so it could be ready to field quite soon. So when you see the movies or you look at comic books or television shows, when you see laser weapons, they tend to be a color, right? Red or green or something like that. Real lasers, one of the key advantages that they provide is that they are invisible. You actually can't see them. You just see this damage suddenly starting to blow something up. So if we take a look now at what the Athena did to a truck. So we're looking at a truck engine, and the Athena within seconds was able to beam right in there, heat the whole thing up, and burn through the engine of this vehicle. So if you imagine if you were in that vehicle, all of a sudden, this hole would start appearing in your engine, and the whole thing would just disappear. That's what these lasers do. Now, there's some other key advantages that we should mention. Let me give you 3 of them. 1, unlimited ammo. As long as we have power, we have an unlimited magazine. And downrange, of course, having unlimited ammo can be a huge advantage. 2, it's silent. You don't give the enemy any advance warning that it's coming. And then the 3rd one I wanted to touch on is that it travels at the speed of light. So not only are we delivering powerful, 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 decisive effects, lethality, we're also doing it so rapidly they don't know what hit them. So if you could circle back to that example of being in the car again, that would happen so instantaneously, within seconds, you truly would have no idea what was happening. It would just suddenly start disintegrating, right? So what can we use these against? So we talked about the vehicle a bit. We talked about how Athena has just proven itself against drones. But in the real world application, our forces could use it against the drones. We could use it against aircraft. We could use it against vehicles on the ground, like we mentioned. We could also use it against fast attack boats. And in fact, Athena's sibling, Adam, a couple years ago proved that it could eliminate these fast attack boats. So if you imagine, boats start trying to swarm one of our ships, not a problem for this laser. burns right through the hull. As you can see right there, it's burning right through the hull. I'm incredibly excited about this news, this great news about the successful testing of Athena, because it means that we'll be putting these powerful weapons soon. We could put them in the hands of our warfighters and give them even more powerful weaponry to keep themselves safe and also to deliver the effects that we need. They can be used, laser weapons can be used offensively and of course defensively too to help protect our homeland. Think of our airports that might be under threat from enemy drones. They could be used to protect our, we could use them statically and used to protect our airports. They could be used to protect our power grid, our nuclear plants. So there's lots of different exciting applications for this technology. There's no longer science fiction, but science fact.
There's no fireman on record talking about how these fires have started in Southern California other than blaming the Santa Ana winds. And as I'll show you from the commentary, these ain't being caused by the Santa Ana winds. And they have the same exact profiles that come in the middle of the night. There's massive kinetic energy developed, EMP powers taken out before the event horizon of the fires begin, or the torched laser EMP events of directed energy weapons have occurred. And it's all part of Energy Agenda 21, which we'll get into a little bit here. But here they're rebuilding the exact same footprint as the laser directed energy weapons targeted. So we're under attack. We're under attack by a government that is not our government. We need to stop the madness. This is from Matt Landman of the fires down in Ventura County. Same exact devastation. Trees still standing. Torch fires in the middle of the night. Melting cars completely through the glass. Completely burnt. And this is all done by lasers.
A haunting but mesmerizing scene from the wildfires in Sonoma County. A man came across this tree burning from the inside out. Matthew McDermott was driving around looking for escape routes as multiple fires closed in on the area he was in. The tree appears that to be hollowed out by embers and flames.
We're all learning about lasers now. We're all learning about the technology they've had available. But as you can clearly see from these pictures here, this is the same type of event horizons where one area is torched and the area right next door to it is completely fine, right along property lines. This could not be by accident. This could not be by just happenstance.
So the recent California fires are very strange and suspect, to say the least. We have specific areas being burned, like energy was being directed at certain things. In drone footage of the aftermath, we see houses completely obliterated and turn to ash while the surrounding landscapes and trees are totally fine. Here is a clip courtesy of Serbian Conspiracy. I'll put a link in the description. You'll notice here that stores and restaurants are wiped out while other things are still in perfect shape. Other buildings are fine, trees are untouched, but specific structures are just devastated. You gotta ask yourself, what's up with that? How did the fires get to these certain buildings, but the surrounding areas, including the parking lot, look normal? Is this the result of direct energy weapons? Ranged weapons that inflict damage on a target by emitting highly focused energy? The answer is most likely yes, but most people believe that these kind of weapons are just science fiction, due to movies like Austin Powers, for instance.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're about to begin phase two of our evil project. Or is it phase three? I don't know phases. Anyways, this is the phase in which we put a giant laser on the moon. As you know, the moon rotates around the Earth like so. When the moon reaches its appropriate lunar alignment, it will destroy Washington, D.C. You see, I've turned the moon into what I like to call a Death Star. What?
Nah, nothing, Darth.
What did you call me?
Nah, nothing.
Rip off! Bless you. Anyways, the key to this plan is the giant laser. It was invented by the noted Cambridge physicist, Dr. Parsons. Therefore, we shall call it the Alan Parsons Project.
Oh my God.
What now?
The Alan Parsons Project is a progressive rock band in 1982.
He's a musician, songwriter, record producer, and audio engineer. He was an engineer on the Let It Be album by the Beatles,
and most notably on Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon. The name Alan Parsons conjures up images and memories of classic rock sounds and albums with his uniquely creative touch. I got to sit down with this musical genius at his private ranch here in Southern California to talk about life, music, and the Grammy.
When I was listening to your music for the first time, there was something unusual about the tone, the nature, and the quality of what you were doing that was different from everyone else.
For sure.
I am the eye in the sky, looking at you. I can read your mind.
What was it like to hear it for the first time as a product outside of the studio and maybe on the radio?
Oh, it was amazing. I mean, it was never off the radio. We went from one city to another doing these promotions, and then all we would hear would be Eye in the Sky. It was amazing. Just one little anecdote about the song. I detested it to start with. Eric brought the song in, and we were trying to find a right feel for it. We played all kinds of different tempos, different feels, and then eventually we just settled on this chugging, and then it was fine. But I've never been allowed to forget that I was ready to drop the song completely.
And the hook, do 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 do, was that your hook or is that his hook?
No, I think that was Eric's.
That was his hook.
But the intro, Serious, that was very much my contribution.
Serious, you know this song from the heyday of the Chicago Bulls.
I always think of them together, Serious and Eye in the Sky, as one piece.
It's real, it's serious, and it's up to us to solve it.
We are faced, I think, with the most challenging geopolitical and geoeconomic situation for decades. We have a weak recovery that easily can turn into a recession. We have not that much movement on the green transition as we have hoped, and we are not out of the woods when it comes to COVID, the pandemic. I think the strength of the World Economic Forum's annual meeting here in Davos is that we have business and governments and civil society together. I know that during this meeting there will be many companies announcing that they will go net zero when it comes to CO2 emissions by 2050. We'll also have a gathering of the largest companies in the world here committing to green their supply chain. So the Apple, Amazons of the world say, we will only buy products from you if you then reduce your CO2 footprint. I think this is very strong signals, and I think this is the strength of our annual meeting.
So many of us are here today is a recognition that the threat from climate change is serious, it is urgent, and it is growing.
It all sounds very green. The Environment Secretary, Ed Davey, has been urging other countries to get serious about tackling climate change.
Now, Sirius is the brightest star in the night sky, which means that it would be pretty easy to spot. And this also means that historically, it would have been also observed by the various cultures, and it would have its mentions in the ancient cultures. So we'll go to that, but let's find Sirius. How to find Sirius? You need to look at the belt of Orion and the 3-point stars downward. The Sirius is to the left. So to be more precise, in coordinate system, Sirius is right ascension 6 hours 45 minutes and 8.9 seconds with declination about minus 16 degrees 42 minutes and 58 seconds.
What do you want me to say? That I knew we were poisoning people, but we didn't want to stop because we were making too much money? Is that what you want me to say?
Madame Curie, is radium a cure for all cancer?
Radium is a cure for all cancer.
Try as I might, I could not remember their faces. I never saw their faces.
Calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious.
What's this?
So radium was the element that was discovered by Madame Curie, and its chemistry is very similar to that of barium, except that it is radioactive.
By far the brightest star in the night sky is Sirius, the dog star. Sirius is more than twice as bright as the next brightest nighttime star, Canopus. It is a particularly beautiful star, with a subtle blue hue to it. On some nights, you may notice Sirius taking on a scintillating, multicolored effect, quickly appearing to cycle through the colors of the rainbow as her atmosphere disturbs its light and bends the different colors different amounts. Sirius was a particularly important star to ancient Egypt. Its appearance in the sky each year coincided with the flooding of the Nile, a crucial event for Egyptian agriculture. The ancient Egyptians personified Sirius as the god Sopdet. Sopdet was a consort of Sa, which we see as the constellation Orion, and the mother of Sopdu, which we see as the planet Venus. For the classical Greeks, the appearance of Sirius and the time just before it was a particularly hot time of the summer. And so the Greeks associated the brilliant star with that time of the year. Sirius being the dog star, this is where we get the phrase, the dog days of summer.
Good morning!
Morning, Truman!
Morning, Spencer!
Hey, Pluto. Oh, no, no!
Get down. He won't hurt you.
My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious shit.
Okay, he's making his turn onto Lancaster Square. Something's wrong. Change frequencies.
Ah!
They were fussed.
What's happened?
Nothing.
Peter, don't tell me what's happening. I'll report you!
City, here we come. Hi.
What now?
Truman, looks like a leak at the plant.
Back up, back up!
It's okay, Truman. I understand. I've been watching you your whole life. I was watching when you were born. I was watching when you took your first step. I watched you on your first day of school.
Dear next president, climate change is the most serious problem facing humankind.
Yeah, we are here all together because we know that the world needs to fight climate change with much, much greater seriousness.
Madam Vice President, you're in charge of the environment for the Iranian government. That's your portfolio. How serious is your government when it comes to tackling climate change, taking serious measures?
Yes, our government is very serious because we adopted a low-carbon economy last year in the government, and we started working in that direction.
Earth's climate is now changing faster than at any point in the history of modern civilization, primarily as a result of human activities, and the climate change could kill thousands of Americans and cost the U.S. economy hundreds of billions of dollars. Pretty seriously. Pretty serious. And you seriously may have missed it because even though the report was supposed to come out in December, the Trump administration released it Friday.
So we're all learning about lasers, and now let's get into how lasers actually work. We had Michio Kaku, poster boy physicist on the Today Show 2 months ago during Hurricane Irma, announcing that had a trillion watt lasers that they were using to manipulate weather. They admitted it on TV very proudly. Here you can see 1,000 watt lasers that are being used handheld to strip the rust off of metal. So different temperatures, and I want you to notice the different colored lights. I've gotten a lot of criticism that there were people reporting blue lights. Well, lasers don't have light fields. Well, that's not true. As you can see in this video, we have white light, we have purple light, we have blue light, and we have green light. And we'll explain that a little more, but it's all based on the type of temperatures being created with these lasers. Anywhere from a quarter watt of power up to a trillion watts of power of these lasers, and you can see it cut right through. It's cutting through, but it's not hurting the metal. It's cleaning it off, but it's not hurting it. Here you see a pipe. You don't see the laser, but you see the effects. You can see it cutting right through, but it's not touching the wood. It's cleaning the metal, but it's not touching the wood, because wood resonates at a different frequency, a different color and density frequency. So that's how you can tell the difference, but it hasn't harmed the wood. Now, if we look at this video coming up right here, we can see it again, torching and cleaning metal in very precise areas using a handheld device. So to use a laser of that power, they say you must have, you know, all this weight and heaviness that would make it the ability to do that. But here we can clearly see a different temperature adjustment. See the purple light, folks, the reddish purple light. It's cleaning off of paper the ink. It is taking ink off paper, blank ink, using a separate temperature to clean it using lasers. This is how precise, this is how accurate, this is how they can do it. I'm showing you right here how they do it. It's been doing it for a very long time. It's just most of the population has been pretty ignorant. Here you see again different colored lasers. That's kind of an oranges purple laser there. So you can see the different colors represent the different intensities of the frequencies. Now watch this coming up here. We see once again, it's cleaning the metal on a straight line. And this looked like, just like the Santa Rosa fires, it looked like a laser had gone through a certain area and then other areas were just left alone. And here they are just stripping metal, very easily done. And it's not even hot to the touch. Now check this out. Here's paper and a pencil. And you can see the writing on the paper. Watch what happens. They clean the writing right off the paper. The paper doesn't even move, and watch this. It even takes the paint right off the wooden pencil, but doesn't touch the pencil itself. This is using 1,000 watts of energy, folks. Again, you can see the different colors of these lasers, and you can see that sometimes you can see the colors, and there's other times when the light is not visible coming from the laser gun itself. Here you can see the purple with the white light. So again, they're using different intensities and different frequencies of energy and power. It's all about power. Here's a white light, you can see the beam. So when people said you saw a blue beam, they were correct. When people say there is no beams on lasers, they are correct. They're both correct. So the color is directly intensity, and they can use it with light or without light, depending on what the projects they're using it on. So it can be used either way. And it also can be used in very, very precise manners, where they can dial in whatever frequency of the object they're looking at. Check this out.
But I don't have turkey. I kind of do. It's more like a tube of turkey, otherwise known as a wiener. So we made it about halfway through, so let's go a little bit slower. Cut number two. Oh, we're close. Test number three, even slower. And I think we've got a full hot dog slice. Kill me! Test number four, I'm gonna go a quarter slower than the last one. And this has got the focal point a little bit further down. God, the smell is really rank. That definitely went all the way through. The moment of truth. Oh, yeah.
So that's how precise it can be. And also, I slowed this down because I just caught it on a very short clip, but it's very analytical as to see how precise and what kind of precision these lasers can burn through. So here is a laser being used to cut and surgically cut into metal here. And it'll come up in just a second. So you can see how this is being used and can be used for targeted areas like California, China, Canada.
We're Earth Shield. You might not know our name, but you've seen us fly in your skies almost every day. And what is our job? Protecting you. You see, the Earth is a dangerous place, and without Earthshield's patented barium formula protecting you, well, I wouldn't like to think of the consequences. You wouldn't send your kids out to play without a thorough coating of sunscreen. Well, just think of us as a gigantic tube of planetary SPF 60. You say, doesn't this cost the taxpayers millions, if not billions of dollars to continually spray our atmosphere? Well, of course it does. But we are committed to keeping your planet preserved and fresh.
City, we finally got out. We're living the dream.
Maybe it is a dream.
Then everything just blew up. Big flash, like a pink light. Or actually, I don't even know what color it was. It wasn't like any color I'd ever seen before.
Looks like a meteorite. You mean it's radioactive? I mean, it's from space, right?
Meteorites are generally no more dangerous than ordinary rocks.
How can something that big just disappear? Did you plant those?
No.
Ward, you come here for a sec.
Oh, God.
What are you doing?
Shh. It's talking to me.
Who's talking to you?
A man in the well.
It's in the static, it's in the moisture. It's in here is out there. And what's out there is in here now.
Everything's under control.
Why are you so in denial? That ding from the meteorite changes everything around it. Do you believe me now?
I don't know what I believe anymore.
Why don't you just call it Operation Wang Chung, ass?
Or what should we?
Nothing. I'm sure Operation Banana Ram will be huge.
What are you saying?
If you want to trying to be hit. www.shh.com.
.org.
You so. Shh.
Dr. Evil, if we could put aside the family squabbling for a moment, I think we could get down to some serious business here.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't like that insolent tone.
I meant nothing by it.
No. You want to run things here?
No, not at all.
Huh? You want to be daddy? Is that it? Number two? You want to wear the daddy pants? Huh? You're going to cry?
Well,
you're
going to
cry?
So.
Huh? Huh? You're going to cry? You're going to cry?
No!
Huh?
What are you?
Huh? You're gonna squirt some? You're gonna cry? Huh?
Oh.
Yeah, see, you're gonna cry, huh? You're a big man now, huh? Yeah, thought so.
Just see for yourself how a well-placed stream of our new and improved Earth Shield grows and expands for maximum coverage. That's because we don't just use any barium in our products. We use the finest barium from the ancient barium mine.
trails. Walking down the sidewalk, what do you know? Lines in the sky making tic-tac-toe. Lines getting bigger, cover up the sky. Blocking out the sun, makes me wonder why. Got on the internet to see what I said. Why are they spraying those chemtrails over my chemtrails? Going to a friend's house, driving down the road. Lines in the sky making Morse code. Different kind of spraying, never saw before. Here comes some airplanes, start to make some more. Silvery haze as far as I can see. Why are they spraying those chemtrails over?
Chemtrails. 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 Chemtrails.
Soaking up the sun. Here come the airplanes to ruin my fun. Day was nice, now graffiti in the sky. Everything is ugly, makes me wanna cry. Geoengineering as far as I can see. Why are they spraying those chemtrails over?
Chemtrails. Chemtrails.
Portugal, you can see how it just cuts right
through the fields of our pots. Feelings part our ways, keeping us close but estranged now. Dreams holding us closer. Meadows of our youth. 7 days, but recalling it backwards, our dreams holding us closer.
Now, one thing I really want your generation to embrace is that the earth is a closed system. We cannot leave the earth. There's no place to go.
Space may be the final frontier, but it's made in a Hollywood basement.
Force field. It's a dome. We're at the edge of the arena.
We hear it so much that it feels like a buzzword, but it is far from it. Climate change is a real and serious issue. But isn't the climate always changing?
America's on the verge of technological breakthroughs that will enable us to live our lives less dependent on oil. And these technologies will help us be better stewards of the environment. And they will help us to confront the serious challenge of global climate change.
Yeah.
Hollywood, the mainstream media, and even publishers of children's books are using predictive programming and deceptive mind games to normalize and present the appearance of the impossible as orthodox science. Students who question the lines in the sky can be ridiculed and bullied by classmates, teachers, and professors, or even arrested on charges of anti-Semitism, because after 9/11, we know who controls America. Don't look at this, look at that, and we will help you keep your head in the clouds.
Forget being on cloud 9, we are on cloud 12, because that's how many new types of clouds have been added to this historic update. Coming from meteorologists, I'm a little biased, right? Exciting stuff, guys. All right, so the new types include the Volatus or roll cloud, which has been designated as a whole new species. You can see it gets its name from this long horizontal tube-like shape. Next one up, we have the cavum or the hole punch cloud. This big circular gap is sometimes caused by aircraft taking off and landing. Very easy to see, right? Makes sense there. And we also have the spiritus. These are gorgeous. It's actually my favorite. It's kind of looking like it waves while you're underwater. I mean, these are actually beautiful. I mean, check these out. And then finally, we also have the big surfer waves of the fluctus cloud. These are actually caused by winds above flowing faster than the winds within the cloud itself, so you kind of get that shape. So beautiful, right? There's just a sample of the new additions that we have. Meteorologists, sky watchers, daydreamers, we're all geeking out, guys.
Watching this clueless little actress presenting her scripted propaganda is insulting to intelligent children and adults alike. She is nothing but a robot impersonating a human being, and it is sad and painful to watch to what low mental level she has been reduced to, exceeding record levels of stupidity.
For the hole punch cloud, this big circular gap is sometimes caused by aircraft taking off and landing. Very easy to see, right? Makes sense there. Sometimes caused by aircraft taking off and landing. Very easy to see, right? Makes sense there.
No, it doesn't make sense that airplanes are punching holes into clouds during takeoff and landing, you clueless twit.
Around the world, it was the warmest ever recorded. And the fact that the climate is changing has very serious implications for the way we live now.
Well, scientists say climate change is getting worse, and there could be serious consequences for our planet in the next 20 years.
Hey, is that his own here yet?
For the millionth time, no. I will budge you the second he gets here. Jeez, I've never seen you so excited. You're like a little girl the morning her brother gets out of jail for beating up a cop. Or Christmas morning.
Michael Foley!
This is like stepping back in time.
The past is prologue, Michael. Men like us have to keep looking to the future.
You know, I've been going over this Millennium Project proposal. There's some great stuff in here. I do think you should tone down the Armageddon end of days rhetoric.
No need to worry, Michael. I have some good news. I'm
the Messiah.
That's a good joke. That's great. You start with that and you keep them light.
No, Michael. I'm serious. The chosen one. The king of kings. The Alpha and the Omega. You're looking at him.
Look, Owen, if this is some kind of joke, let me just say, good one. I get it. That's, ha.
I'm as shocked as you are, believe me. This is a big responsibility. I mean, look at this.
Things to do. Banish Satan and the forces of evil. Build the New Jerusalem. Buy milk.
Milk. I keep forgetting to pick up milk.
Owen, you can't be serious.
Look, Michael, I know I'm supposed to be able to do this all by myself, being the Son of God and all. But I'm feeling a lot of pressure. So I was thinking, maybe you could help me.
You want me to help you, banish Satan and establish God's kingdom on earth?
If you're not too busy.
So, I hear you've been out of the game for a while. Are you sure you're still as sharp as Mike says?
How long have you been dating your secretary?
About a week.
UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres says it's time to get serious about keeping ambitions high on climate action and on building resilience.
With science forecasting a dramatic rise in both the frequency and severity of disasters, it's time to get serious about keeping ambitions high on climate action and on building resilience and reducing disaster risk.
You like this, don't you? Yes, you do. Yeah. All right. That's about all, kiddo. There you go. There you are. You just stay right there, Rags, all right?
The doth.
He's alive. It's a miracle.
I'm the Messiah. I'm serious. The chosen one. The king of kings. The Alpha and the Omega. You're looking at him.
Sirius is the brightest star in the whole sky and is part of the constellation Canis Major. Canis comes from the root word canine, and therefore it is also called the dog star. Canis Minor constellation is also besides Canis Major.
In Indian legends, this Sirius constellation is called Uma Gauri, indicating that it is a twin star. And Gauri, the word Gauri means pale, white, indicates that one of the twin stars is a white star. It is only in 1767 that Englishman John Mitchell proposed that the Sirius is a twin star system, and in 1804 William Herschel confirmed this and called them Sirius A and Sirius B. Now Indian legends also go one step further and propose this to be Kala Bhairava form of Shiva, with Canis Major and Canis Minor, two dogs which go along with him. Kala Bhairava has two dogs going along with him. And the word Canis means dog, canine. Does there seem to be some connect?
My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious.
Everyone's so busy keeping up. Forget about the Joneses, we all on our telephones with the texts and the tweets and the beats. What he said, she said, can't even follow the thread. Down the hole, we all go. Me, I like keeping up too, with my corona and my attitude. That's the fine life, baby.
Hey Jude.
Because it's how you have a child, Visa.
Close call.
Bavaria Rama. Lekker relaxed.
Thing is a bit more confusing. It's terrifying when you're too dumb to know who's stupid. And unfortunately, that's where I find myself. And the only people who really know are the people that are working at Harp. And none of them are talking. And I wouldn't talk either. And none of them are talking. And I wouldn't talk either. Are the world's governments manipulating the weather and creating huge zombie freak storm? I'll tell the government right now. Tell you right now, if you're listening, NSA, CIA, I'm available, okay? If you show me all the real wreckage, I swear to God, I will make fun of that crap to the end of time. I'll make up stories. I'll lie to my mother. I don't care. You show me a UFO, I'll lie to my mother.
They are the ones that are doing this kind of nonsense. So really, they want to blame humanity, but the establishment are the ones that are doing it. So it is, again, the Hegelian dialectic. They like to make it seem like we're doing it. Even the duality, as above, so below. It's exactly how Satan works. You know, he's the one doing the nonsense, but of course he lies. He's the father of lies, and they follow in his footsteps. So they're going to do the exact same things. And even, of course, good old Wernher von Braun spoke about this when he said that, you know, talking about the weaponization of space and space-based weapons and all this kind of thing. So really, this is nothing new under the sun here. We are being shown the same things over and over again, that they have these weapons. Even though people like myself and others who believe this are labeled as conspiracy theorists, but really they like to make people like us look very crazy. But that's just not the case, in my opinion, that the Illuminati cabal, they are the ones behind all of this. Many of us know that Wernher von Braun was a high-level Freemason and part of the Nazi regime as well, who was brought over to America by good old Project Paperclip so that they could continue his Luciferian work. And of course, he is the founder, or one of the founding members, of NASA. So, you know, they are the ones that are destroying the Earth.
Richard and I have been building rockets since we were teenagers. We want to change aviation history forever. Our ultimate goal is to take man into space.
Man into space. It is a comic book fantasy. You will blow yourself up.
How'd it go?
Every time I think we're making headway, we take a step back.
The bank called again. We're 2 months behind.
You truly believe that you, Jack Parsons, can build a rocket that will take us all to the moon?
Yes.
Preposterous.
Looks like someone's moving into the old Weller place. Who moves in the middle of the night?
We'll have to go introduce ourselves. Hi, we're Mr. and Mrs. Parsons from next door.
I'm Ernest. I'll take that.
My wife thinks you got a screw loose.
I'm trying to find my true path.
There's only two kinds of people in this whole world. The ones who want to follow the rules, and the ones who want to break them. Who says we have to obey?
Father, how do you know when you're in the presence of evil? Jack seems compelled.
My father taught me about symbols like this. He said that they were gateways.
Gateways to what?
Rockets are the future, whether you want to believe in them or not.
You can be the man you've always dreamed of being. You just need to have an open mind.
I promise you, our life will never be boring.
NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, is a United States government federal agency. Their website has a database of major earthquakes throughout history. According to their website, in 33 AD, the earthquake occurred at the crucifixion. That is, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. This account matches the historical record in the Holy Bible. Jesus Christ was about 33 years old when he was crucified. There was an earthquake and the sun was darkened. According to their website, in the nation we today call Israel, which was previously called Palestine, back in the year 33 AD, they show that an earthquake occurred that destroyed a city, and in their words, it was at the crucifixion. This is based on their references dating back from 1853 and 1985. This matches the account given in the Holy Bible, which shows that Jesus Christ, when he was about 33 years old, was crucified. The sun was darkened, and there was a great earthquake.
Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, Truly this was the Son of God.
Storm's coming.
Storm's coming.
Storm's coming.
Storm's coming.
Storm's coming.
The great storm is coming. The wind that overturns the land.
The storm is coming.
There is a storm coming.
Hey, Cody, there's a storm coming.
I told you. It's raining. That's unbelievable. Oh, NASA's playing God. It's making its own weather.
Storm coming, kids. Let's get inside.
You can't sleep outside. There's a storm coming.
Storm's coming.
Oh, you all better get your umbrellas out because there's a storm coming. Come on, hurry, give it to him.
There's a storm coming.
What?
There's a storm coming, buddy. There's a storm coming.
God knows the beginning from the end. This is why we understand how prophecies work. And he said in the end that the Son of God, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, all religions looking forward to some Messiah, as it were, to return, many calling for the Mahdi or the Antichrist that would come first. But we're told in Scripture that Jesus Christ will come back. And in his return, according to Zechariah, when he sets his foot down upon the Mount of Zion, that it will be split, that an earthquake is going to happen like never was since the beginning of time, up to that time or ever would be again. We're told that it's going to literally, at his return, shake the heavens. You gotta understand this. You may not believe it, you may not want to hear this, but it still should be considered because there are many who believe it to be true. If the Son of the living God, who created all things by his word, says that he's coming back as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and with his vesture dipped, in Revelations 19 and 13, it says his name is the Word of God. Are you with me so far? It also says when he returns, that the angel of God will declare that time shall be no more. Time is important here, folks. We're on a linear timeline. That's what we understand. We're moving forward. Yes, there is Anderson Institute, Fermi Labs, all these other places, even CERN, trying to manipulate time, to try and twist, to try and go back, or to escape for whatever reason it is that they're doing. Trying to open portals to other dimensions, the spiritual realm that we've known forever that it exists, that angelic realm where the fallen and the righteous both dwell. But this return of Christ is going to shake the foundations of all creation from the beginning to the end, all the way back to Adam. That ripple, as it goes back in time, smooths out. People are saying, well, these changes have been occurring all throughout life. And that's probably a truth to that, because the ripples from that main impact, the end of time, as it were, will go out and level out. And the closer we get to that coming, the more frequency and the higher and the harder we're going to see these things occurring. So, I suggest that you look into this. Don't take my word for it. Go before God. God will make himself real to you. People who don't believe in God have not had an experience with God. Many people, well, I'm Christian, I'm this, that. You worship with lip service and your heart is far from him. Not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, in that day is going to enter into the kingdom. These are all scriptures that we're told. But when he comes back as the King of Kings to set up his kingdom here, then a time is going to go, a ripple shooting forth, that he will destroy the Antichrist with the brightness of his coming. You got to understand, every eye shall see and every knee will bow and every tongue shall confess. On that day, the rich men are going to hide in their dens and in their bunkers and call for the rocks to fall upon them and hide them from the face of him that sits upon the throne. I'm telling you, this is what's causing the changes to the human anatomy. A rock hitting the earth and destroying it is not going to change your liver and give you a larger liver to be able to filter the system or filter the poisons. Your bone structure now seems to be more armored, if you will. Your heart now is more in the center, not to the left, they say. It's more right on there. The kidneys. Remember the kidney punch? It was illegal in boxing. And now, instead of having your kidneys here, they're up inside the rib cage, more protected. Amazing, amazing. Hitler's eyes changed from brown to blue, according to what they're saying in the Mandela Effect community. Something so big and so catastrophic, the end of time, as it were, has hit in the future. That's prophecy. That's what that is about. And when it happened, now listen, we battle not against flesh and blood, but principalities and evils. In that spiritual realm, those dimensions they're trying to open. There is a constant thing with these waves going in or out from the electromagnetic pulses that they're shooting through CERN's electromagnetic waves that are disturbing the human resonance that's messing with the minds of man. People have been given over to blindness and delusion, can't see the changes, the majority can't, and those that do now are saying, oh, we've created the reality, we're making our own. Well, we know that's garbage. Most of the people that think they're changing and making their own reality, their marriages are messed up, they're in bad relationships, their jobs are falling apart, people think they're crazy. That's the kind of reality you've manipulated? No, give God the credit. He made us. He made us. And His Son is going to return. And at that return, the time when He sits down, even the heavens shall be shaken. That's what it says. That's what the Scripture says. And the closer we get to that, the more intense those waves and that frequency. And we're going to see the increase of weather. We're going to see the increase of more earthquakes and more catastrophic wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not soon shaken. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. But we are moving toward that. Folks, you're not guaranteed your next breath or your next heartbeat. Get it right with God. This ain't about joining a church, getting your name on a charter. This ain't about a religious thing. This is about a communication with your Creator, having a real relationship, and letting the Holy Spirit give you the understanding and take you into all understanding. You have no need of a man to teach you, or a woman. You have no need of any human. All you need is to know God and Yeshua, the Son of the living God, Jesus the Christ. When He sets His foot down, it's going to send this change, a molecular world. It's going to rock everything all the way back to the beginning of Adam. It's back. That's where these changes are coming from, because only God can change your human anatomy in such a way as has taken place. Oh, they're trying to fight against it with their waves and the things that they're doing with their G network or I-5 network or G-5 or whatever it is that's going on. But I'm going to tell you, you need to consider this. If you're looking into retrocausality, don't look at it as a rock hitting the earth. Don't give CERN and man all the credit. And don't even give Lucifer all the credit. He gets some, but not all. But give Yeshua, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, a try. Because when He comes, time shall be no more.
Thank you. Shall be given to you. Seek and ye shall.